Thanks everyone for coming, and thanks to Tom for inviting me. I wrote an essay about logistics that I published, I think, 4 years ago, and I've since then been working on related topics, agriculture, planning, and this invitation was a great opportunity for me to revisit those ideas and think about how they hold up in the present political moment, you know, with this kind of right populist and, in some cases, neo-fascist turn. And you know, I think that the argument does hold up, but there are new things that I want to think about. And I should also say that in the years since, there's been just a real flowering of scholarship on this topic. And you know, so there's a lot that people have done, and a lot of new knowledge being produced. So logistics and counter-logistics in the age of walled flows. There are many names for the present era: the age of financialization, the information age, the age of deindustrialization, of surplus populations and precarity. In terms of tactics, however, we live in the age of the blockade. From Mexico to Egypt, from France to the United States, when antagonists to the ruling powers aim to make their unhappiness felt, to impose their will on a cruel and indifferent world, they often do so by interrupting the voluminous, turbulent flows of goods and people upon which contemporary society depends. And I have just a couple of images. You know, here's kind of an image of a French blockade, and this kind of slogan, "Blocons tout," has, you know, flowered in France for, like, I guess the last 5 years. It's become a kind of watchword, and they're always blockading things. Maybe not everything, but many things. Here's Mexico, where, you know, there's been an increasing number of these kind of highway blockades, sometimes exacting tolls. This is particularly from the moment of the kind of teachers' struggle in Ayotzinapa that led to the massacre of 43 people, and then led to further blockades and further struggles. So that's a incredibly common tactic within Mexico at present and growing in significance. There's Gezi Park in Turkey, a blockade, a barricade. And here's the US. I'll talk a little bit about the kind of proliferation of freeway blockades in the context of Black Lives Matter. And I'll just leave that up there because I'll get to it. Tactics tell us very little, of course, on their own, when abstracted from the people who employ them in pursuit of particular goals and with particular strategic aims. The blockade is a form that can carry many different contents and can be employed by fascists and communists, by governments and popular movements alike. But history has a way of forging a compact between particular tactics and particular strategies. Such was the relationship, for example, between the strike and the workers' movement in the 19th and 20th century. The proliferation of the blockade and the other tactics with which it is associated, the plaza occupation or militant encampment, the riot, occurs as a visible face of what Joshua Clover has called circulation struggles, antagonist movements that no longer occur in the site of production but outside it, among the reticulated flows of our deindustrializing societies. Along with Clover and other intellectual comrades, I have endeavored to explain the tactical and strategic shifts we note as responses to an ongoing restructuring of capitalism, superintended by the so-called logistics revolution, and we should really think of it as a counter-revolution, that has massively increased the power of capital contra labor. Theory is imminent to social movements and antagonist projects, and therefore we can read off of tactics an organic understanding by participants of the changed landscape they inhabit, one that quite often outstrips that of outright theoreticians themselves. 5 years ago, I began studying logistics because it was the only way I could make sense of what I had noticed in the movements in which I had participated. In particular, I was interested in articulating the emergent sensibility and strategic orientation of the Occupy movement and its radical Oakland contingent, which, in November 2011, declared a general strike, shut down much of downtown Oakland, and then marched to the port and blockaded it. And that's an image of that blockade. The intervening years have vindicated this perspective, especially in the U.S., where nearly every significant political movement has foregrounded the blockade. In 2000, and here's the kind of thing. Oh, that's next. In 2014, the transformation of local anti-police riots and protests into a national movement, eventually dubbed Black Lives Matter, occurred in part through the tactical proliferation of the freeway blockade. At its peak, there were blockades in over 70 cities, from large metropolises such as Oakland and Chicago and New York, to smaller cities such as Providence, Rhode Island, and Nashville, Tennessee. Most recently, we have seen in Standing Rock, South Dakota, the emergence of the most significant moment of Native American resistance since the 1970s, with the blockade of the Dakota Access Oil Pipeline by Lakota Sioux and other allies. In November, protesters at Standing Rock were able to force the government to halt construction of the pipeline, but as soon as Donald Trump came into office, he reversed that decision. These new developments are a vindication of my earlier writing, but they also complicate it and merit theoretical refinement. This re-engagement with the theory is a synthesis of conversations and debates that are occurring continuously within the movement of our time, as people try to grapple with the perils and possibilities of the moment. Trump, that is, you know, people are already talking about these blockades and what they mean. Trump promises to unify movements such as Black Lives Matter and the No Dapple protests at Standing Rock, but he does so as one manifestation of a right populism and neo-fascism that is, at least rhetorically, opposed to the logistical globalization of capital. As much as he promotes oil exploration and pipelines and makes oil CEO Rex Tillerson his Secretary of State, he also promises to line the U.S. southern border with a wall and levy tariffs against China in order to domesticate internationalized production. There is a danger, in other words, that our blockades merely reproduce theirs. As such, the moment requires an understanding of the relationship of the logistics revolution to the nation state and national security state in order that we can encompass antagonist movements against both oil pipeline and border wall, against the toxic flows of the black snake and the imprisoning barricade of the border. And so, since I think probably a lot of people don't know the earlier essay, I'm going to kind of read from that and just give a general outline of what logistics is, as I understand it. Logistics takes as its object not the factory or isolated site of production, but the entire supply chain, stretching from mines to retailers. Today's supply chains are distinguished not just by their planetary extension and incredible speed, but by their direct integration of manufacture and retail, their harmonization of the rhythms of production and consumption. Since the 1980s, business writers have touted the value of lean and flexible production models, in which suppliers maintain the capacity to expand and contract production, as well as change the types of commodities produced by relying on a network of subcontractors, temporary workers, and mutable organizational structures. Adaptations that require precise control over the flow of goods and information between units. Originally associated with the Toyota production system and Japanese manufacturers in general, these corporate forms are now frequently identified with the loose moniker just-in-time, which refers in a specific sense to a form of inventory management and in general to a production philosophy in which firms aim to eliminate standing inventory, whether produced in-house or derived from suppliers. Received from suppliers. Derived in part from the Japanese and in part from Anglo-American cybernetics, JIT is a circulationist production philosophy oriented around a concept of continuous flow that views everything not in motion as a form of waste, a drag on profits. Just-in-time aims to submit all production to the condition of circulation, pushing its velocity as far toward the light speed of information transmission as possible. From the perspective of our blockaders, this emphasis on the quick and continuous flow of commodities multiplies the power of the blockade. In the absence of standing inventories, a blockade of just a few days could effectively paralyze many manufacturers and retailers. In just-in-time systems, manufacturers must coordinate upstream suppliers with downstream buyers, so speed alone is insufficient. Timing is crucial. Through precise coordination, firms can invert the traditional buyer-seller relationship in which goods are first produced and then sold to a consumer. By replenishing goods at the exact moment they are sold, with no buildup of stocks along the way, just-in-time firms perform a weird sort of time travel, making it seem as if they only make products that have already been sold to the end consumer. As opposed to the older push production model, in which factories generated massive stockpiles of goods that retailers would clear from the market with promotions and coupons, in today's pull production systems, retailers share point of sale information with their vendors, who can then rapidly replenish the retailer's stock. This has led to the functional integration of suppliers and retailers under terms in which the retailers often have the upper hand. Massive buyers like Walmart reduce their suppliers to mere vassals, directly controlling product design and pricing while still retaining the flexibility to terminate a contract if needed. They gain the benefits of vertical integration without the liability that comes from formal ownership. Whereas in the early 1980s, some thought that the emphasis on flexibility and dynamism would shift the balance of power from big, inflexible multinationals to small, agile firms, lean production has instead only meant a phase change rather than a weakening of the power of multinational firms. The new arrangement features what Bennett Harrison has called the concentration without centralization of corporate authority. Lean manufacturing, flexibility, just-in-time inventory systems, pull production, each one of these innovations, interrelated, now forms a component part of the so-called logistics revolution and the corresponding logistics industry, which consists of in-house and third-party specialists in supply chain design and management. Enabled by the technical transformations of the shipping and transport industry, containerization in particular, as well as the possibilities afforded by information and communications technology, logistics workers now coordinate different productive moments and circulatory flows across vast international distances, ensuring that the where and when of the commodity obtains to the precision and speed of data. Confirming the veracity of the oft-quoted passage from Marx's Grundrisse about the tendential development of the world market, through logistics, capital strives simultaneously for a greater extension of the market and for greater annihilation of space by time. But logistics is more than the extension of the world market in space and the acceleration of commodal flows. It is the active power to coordinate and choreograph, the power to conjoin and split flows, to speed up and slow down, to change the type of commodity produced in its origin and destination point, and finally, to collect and distribute knowledge about the production, movement, and sale of commodities as they stream across the grid. Logistics is a multivalent term. It names an industry in its own right, composed of firms that handle the administration of shipping and receiving for other corporations, as well as an activity that many businesses handle internally. But it also refers, metonymically, to a transformation of capitalist production overall, the logistics revolution. In this latter sense, logistics indexes the subordination of production to the conditions of circulation, the becoming hegemonic of those aspects of the production process that involve circulation. In the idealized world picture of logistics, manufacture is merely one moment in a continuous Heraclitean flux. The factory dissolves into planetary flows, chopped up into modular component processes which, separated by thousands of miles, combine and recombine according to the changing whims of capital. Logistics aims to transmute all fixed capital into circulating capital. the better to imitate and conform to the purest and most liquid of forms capital takes, money. This is impossible, of course, since the valorization process requires fixed capital outlays at some point along the circuits of reproduction, and therefore someone, somewhere, will have to shoulder the risk that comes with investing in immobile plant and machinery. But logistics is about mitigating this risk. It is about transforming a mode of production into a mode of circulation, in which the frequencies and channel capacities of the circuits of capital are what matters. In this, the logistics revolution conforms to the hydraulic conception of capitalism outlined by Deleuze and Guattari in the 1970s, in which surplus value results not so much from the irreversible transformation of worked matter, but from the conjunction of one flow, money, with another, labor. In this account, influenced by Fernand Braudel's description of the origins of capitalism and its revision by world systems theory, capital is nothing so much as a commander of flows, breaking and conjoining various currents in order to create a vast irrigation and drainage of social power. Logistics turns solids into liquids, or at its extreme, into electrical fields, taking the movement of discrete elements and treating them as if they were oil in a pipeline, flowing continuously at precisely adjustable pressures. So far, we've only described what the logistics revolution is, leaving unanswered the most important question: why did capital reorganize in this manner, in pursuit of which advantages in response to which impasses? One answer, hinted at above, is that logistics is a simple accelerator of commodity flows. Logistics is a method to decrease the turnover time of capital and thereby raise total profits. Short turnover times and quick production cycles can produce very high total profits with even the very low rates of profit per turnover which capitalists encountered in the 1970s. Logistics was one solution then to the long downturn that emerged in the 1970s and the general crisis it ushered in, as opportunities for profit taking through investment in the productive apparatus, in new plant and machinery, began to vanish. As we know from numerous accounts, one result is that capital flowed into financial assets, real estate, and the like, amplifying the velocity and bandwidth of the money supply in the credit market and concocting novel forms of finance capital. But this well-documented process of financialization had as its hidden counterpart a massive investment of capital in the complementary sphere of commodity rather than money circulation, increasing the throughput of the transportation system and accelerating the velocity of commodity capital through a build-out in the form of tankers, port complexes, rail yards, robotically controlled distribution centers, and the digital and network technology needed to manage the increased volume and complexity of trade. The shipping container and the commodity future were thus complementary technical innovations, streamlining and supercharging different segments of the total circuit of reproduction. The ever faster rotations of credit and commodities around the globe are mutually enabling relays. However, investment in these areas is not just about brute velocity. It also aims at reducing the associated costs of circulation and thereby increasing the total load of the transport system. Alongside the obvious economies of scale and mechanization afforded by container technology, integrated information systems vastly reduce the administrative costs associated with circulation, freeing up more money for direct investment in production. But these developments cannot be understood in terms of quantitative increase and decrease alone. Increase in speed and volume of commodity flows, decrease in overhead. There is an important qualitative goal here as well, described by logistics as agility, that is, the power to change as quickly as possible the speed, location, origin, and destination of products as well as product type, in order to meet volatile market conditions. Corporations aim for responsive supply chains, as the chapter title of one popular logistics handbook has it, such that they can respond in shorter time frames, both in terms of volume change and variety changes. In their interventive role, logistics experts might seek to identify and remedy bottlenecks in order to maintain agility. But as a matter of preventative design, specialists will strive to synchronize and distribute information across the entire supply chain so that suppliers can take appropriate action before intervention becomes necessary. This distributed information is referred to as a virtual supply chain, a chain of transmitted symbolic representations that flows opposite to the physical movement of commodities. Entirely separate firms might use distributed data of this sort to connect, to coordinate their activities. The result, as Edna Bonosich and Jake Wilson note, is that competition shifts from the firm level to the supply chain level. But transparency of data does not level the playing field at all. Typically, one of the actors in the supply chain network will retain dominance without necessarily placing itself at the center of operations. Walmart, for instance, has insisted its suppliers place radio frequency identification tags on pallets and containers, allowing it to manage its inventory much more effectively at considerable cost to the suppliers. Before we consider the final reason for the logistics revolution, and the most important one in my view, a brief historical note is in order. Until World War II, the field of corporate or business logistics did not exist at all. Instead, logistics was a purely military affair, referring to the methods that armies used to provision themselves, moving supplies from the rear to the front line, a mundane but fundamental enterprise, which military historians since Thucydides have acknowledged as a key determinant of the success of expeditionary wars. Business logistics as a distinct field evolved in the 1950s, building upon innovations in military logistics and drawing upon the interchange of personnel between the military, industry, and the academy so characteristic of the post-war period. Interchanges superintended by the fields of cybernetics, information theory, and operations research. The connection between military and corporate logistics remained intimate. For instance, although Malcolm McLean introduced stackable shipping containers in the 1950s and had already managed to containerize some domestic transport lines, it was his Sea Land Services container-based solution to the logistics crisis of the Vietnam War that generalized the technology and demonstrated its effectiveness for international trade. Likewise, radio frequency ID technology was first deployed by the U.S. military in Iraq and Afghanistan, at which point Walmart began exploring its use. Shortly afterwards, the Department of Defense and Walmart issued mandates to their largest suppliers requiring them to use RFID tags on their merchandise. The link between corporate logistics and military logistics is so strong that many of Walmart's managers and executives who set the standard for the industry as a whole come from the military, the Air Force usually. Logistics, we might say, is war by other means, war by means of trade. A war of supply chains that conquers new territories by suffusing them with capillary distributions, ensuring that commodities flow with ease to the farthest extremities. From this martial perspective, we might usefully distinguish, however, between an offensive and a defensive logistics. The offensive forms we have already described above, logistics seeks to saturate markets, reduce costs, and outproduce competitors, maintain maximum throughput and maximum product variety. In this offensive aspect, logistics emphasizes flexibility, plasticity, permutability, dynamism, and morphogenesis. But it finds its complement in a series of protocols which are fundamentally defensive, mitigating supply chain risk from blockades and earthquakes, strikes, and supplier shortages. If agility is the watchword of offensive logistics, defensive logistics aims for resilience. And since I've written this, that word has become, you know, only more prevalent. And emphasizes the values of elasticity, homeostasis, stability, and longevity. But resilience is only ostensibly a conservative principle. It finds stability not in inflexibility, but in constant self-stabilizing adaptivity. In this sense, The defensive and the offensive forms of logistics are really impossible to disentangle, since one firm's agility is another's volatility, and the more flexible and dynamic a firm becomes, the more it exports uncertainty to the system as a whole, requiring other firms to become more resilient. In any case, we can expect that in the context of the economic crisis and the looming environmental collapse, logistics will become more and more the science of risk management and crisis mitigation. Logistics is capital's art of war, a series of techniques for intercapitalist and interstate competition. But such wars are, at the same time, always fought through and against workers. One of the most significant reasons for the extension, complication, and lubrication of these planetary supply chains is that they allow for arbitrage of the labor market. And this is probably the key point for me. The sophisticated, permutable supply chains of the contemporary world make it possible for capital to seek out the lowest wages anywhere in the world and to play proletarians off of each other. Logistics was therefore one of the key weapons in a decades-long global offensive against labor. The planetary supply chains enabled by containerization effectively encircled labor, laying siege to its defensive emplacements, such as unions, and eventually, over the course of the 1980s and 1990s, completely crushing them. From there, with labor on the run, logistics has enabled capital to quickly neutralize and outmaneuver whatever feeble resistance workers mount. Although capital must deal with the problem of sunk investments in immovable buildings, machines, and other infrastructures, reconfigurable supply chains allow it unprecedented power to root around and starve troublesome labor forces. By splitting workers into a core composed of permanent workers, often conservative, better paid, and loyal, and a periphery of casualized, outsourced, and fragmented workers who may or may not work for the same firm, capital has dispersed proletarian resistance quite effectively. But these organizational structures require systems of coordination, communication, and transport, opening capital up to the danger of disruption in the space of circulation, whether by workers charged with circulating commodities or by others, as with the port blockade, who choose circulation as their space of effective action, for the simple reason that capital has already made this choice as well. The actions of the participants in the port blockade are, in this regard, doubly determined by the restructuring of capital. They are there not only because the restructuring of capital has either left them with no jobs at all or placed them into jobs where action as workers, according to the classical tactics of the workers' movement, has been prescribed, but also because capital itself has increasingly taken the sphere of circulation as the objects of its own interventions. In this regard, theory provides us not only with the why of capital's restructuring, but the why of a new cycle of struggles. So now I'm transitioning back away from rereading the earlier article. Some workers do have incredible power in our logistical world. In Egypt, a strike by Suez Canal workers played an important role in forcing Mubarak from power. In France, the mobilizations that have followed each proposed change in labor law often involve a strike at core industries such as refineries, and then a much larger mass of roving blockaders and rioters who aim to bring the economy to a halt, often marching under banners adorned with the resonant slogan, "Blocons tout." But it would be foolhardy to base a strategy, as many contemporary Trotskyists do, around these essential workers, given that they form a minuscule part of the total workforce. Capital can and will easily neutralize them with either incentives or repression, and political strategy must reckon with the question of what everyone else will do, instead of waiting to be liberated by the substitutionist actions of a few thousand dock workers. The black youth of Ferguson and Oakland do not find themselves, for the most part, employed in such industries. Some of them work, many of them don't, but those who do will work in small job sites, often on a contingent or part-time basis, and find little opportunity to make their power felt. And so they take to the freeways, provisionally, in search of more powerful ways to interrupt the flows. We must remember that for residents of these American cities, these freeways are flows that, at the same time, function as walls, dividing the city into poorer and wealthier parts, flowing along long-standing racialized demarcations that serve to segregate and divide. The freeway is a flowing border, and the contemporary ghetto is, in most cities, produced by its bisections and enclosures. Therefore, when our blockaders march onto the off-ramp, a flow against the flow, they are both interrupting a flow and breaking through a barrier. They are a flow breaking through a wall, a flow become a wall to another flow. We might therefore summarize the rule of the logistical world as follows. Every flow can be a wall. What? Okay. So, there was an important picture from Berkeley from the moment when these blockades became general. Instead of the typical image of the freeway with streaky red taillights on the right and streaky white headlights on the left, the two directions of traffic are bisected and blocked so as to produce four quadrants. In the bottom right, the red lights of outbound traffic come to a stop in the middle of the frame. In the top left, headlights. And between them, a barely visible mass flowing across all the lanes, opening up the dark diagonal that pours through top right and bottom left quadrants. A flow, a wall. The blockade has, in other words, opened a new route. To walk down those empty outbound lanes and inbound lanes is to go somewhere the freeway can't, in normal political weather, take you. From the perspective of the capitalist firm, logistics is both flow and wall. Supply chains connect firms, but they also disconnect them through competition. Firms that produce, distribute, or purchase a product want to sell it to everyone possible, but they also want to be the only ones doing so. And therefore, they try to dominate supply chains and crowd out other competitors, either by establishing superior routes and networks or establishing proprietary relations with their suppliers. Furthermore, as we've seen, the monopolization of supply chains and points of connection by suppliers is designed to fragment and disconnect labor. Logistical globalization is not a simple flattening of the world, and many people have argued against this vulgar view, in which every point is connected to every other point, but an uneven, tangled topology constituted by branching linkages, but filled with tears and holes. The presence of the nation-state ramifies and intensifies these uneven and torn topologies. The presence of fluctuating exchange rates between nations, trade regulations that hinder some firms and help others, and various administrative protocols that block entry to particular markets means that firms, by and large, clump together into national blocks, with only a very few companies becoming so multinational in production, financing, and distribution of sales that they have escaped a relation of mutual dependence with one nation state in particular. To be sure, large international firms require relations of mutuality with more than one nation, but they also depend upon the supports they are given from the state where they are located in order to ward off competitors. Writing during a previous period of globalizing capital, Karl Kautsky illuminates these contradictory impulses. And so I have a long quote from Kautsky that I think is really illuminating about this and very much in line with what a lot of scholars of logistics are kind of saying about the relationship between flows and borders and nations. International commerce is inevitably connected with a capitalist system of production. The development of capitalism out of early simple production of commodities is most intimately connected with the growth of world commerce. But world commerce is impossible without peaceful intercourse among the various nations. It requires that a foreign merchant be protected equally with a native. The capitalist system of production, however, develops the most remarkable contradictions. Hand in hand with the movement toward international brotherhood goes a tendency to emphasize international differences. Commerce demands peace, but competition leads to war. If, in each country, the different capitalists and classes are in a state of war, so are the capitalist classes of the various countries. Each nation tries to extend the markets for its own goods by crowding out the goods of other nations. The more complex becomes international commerce, the more essential international peace. The fiercer grows the competitive struggle, and the greater the danger of conflict between nations. The closer the international relations which are developed, the louder swells the demand for attention to separate national interests. The more urgent the need of peace, the greater the danger of war. These are apparently impossible antitheses. These apparently impossible antitheses correspond exactly to the character of capitalist production. They lie hidden in the simple production of commodities, but only capitalist production develops them till they become intolerable. That it develops at the same time the necessity of peace and the tendency toward war is only one of the contradictions which will bring about the destruction of the capitalist system. Logistics is a means whereby these two contradictory impulses are at least partially reconciled, the impulse toward war subsumed within the trade relation. As we've already seen in our examination of its origins, logistics is a kind of trade fair, war as trade. Logistics is a mechanism of both linkage and competition. It opens up certain markets while closing down others. This is because logistics infrastructure is often promoted and organized by particular nation states in consort with domestic and international firms. At the heart of these national projects are the gateway and corridor initiatives that sweep from the interior of one country into another, built around enhanced cross-border transportation infrastructure, rail lines, intermodal shipping ports, and the integration, standardization, and synchronization of customs and trade regulations, ensuring the smooth flow of goods from one country to the next across specific expedited border posts or gateways. In The Deadly Life of Logistics, Deborah Cowan describes one such initiative, the Asia-Pacific Corridor and Gateway Initiative, which links East Asian suppliers to U.S. and Canadian markets. Goods bound for the U.S. on ships from East Asian ports travel through Canada, but inspected by both Canadian and U.S. customs officials at their Canadian ports of entry, traveling directly to Chicago without stopping. The corridor allows for a supersession of the border, or rather a projection of the U.S. border into Canadian space. But this lubrication of flows between Asia and North America should be understood as blocking other routes of flow, either through ports in Mexico, which are also trying to attract this trade, or the U.S. West Coast. A corridor is, let's remember, a walled flow. And across the world, corridor projects are part of an antagonistic geopolitics, as countries create exclusive alliances, opening to some and closing off to others. Key to this story are the extensive trade corridor projects that China has undertaken in order to reduce its dependence on U.S. markets, linking it to Southeast Asia and to Europe and Africa along the ancient overland routes of the Silk Road. Gateways and corridors are the means whereby the national whereby national blocks of capital might pivot away from certain markets and toward others in search of new trade opportunities. They are also fundamentally about ensuring access to key resources, energy resources in particular, and cutting out troublesome mediators. The fact that gateway and corridor geographies enable both international competition and international cooperation can make sense of the contradictions of ascendant right populist and neo-fascist politics. Many of us in the U.S. have been struck, and not just in the U.S., but everybody's observing this, many of us have been struck by the difference between the economic nationalism of Trump advisor Stephen Bannon, who wants to cut off trade with China via tariffs, domesticate production, and seal off the southern border, and the implicit political stance of others in the Trump regime, such as former Exxon CEO Rex Tillerson, now Secretary of State, who understands as well as anyone that U.S. corporations produce, distribute, and sell products worldwide and can't be domesticated without extremely negative consequences. And I should say that, you know, in the last couple of weeks, we've really seen the kind of neoliberal wing of the Trump project assert its dominance and probably, you know, and really smash this other economic nationalist side. You know, and perhaps they'll come back, and it's unclear, but which is probably, you know, which is as expected. So these are real contradictions, ones that can't ultimately be overcome except in rhetoric. At present, Trump's economic proposals try to have it both ways and propose to fight neoliberal globalization with neoliberal means. He spoke very loudly about how his administration would, recognizing the importance of transportation and communication networks to the contemporary economy, devote $1 trillion, to domestic infrastructure projects. But instead of building airports and ports and roads directly, as right and left governments in the past might have, he intends to offer tax credits and deregulation as indirect incentives, a process that will surely not have the desired result. This is an attempt to reconcile economic nationalism with the deregulating and internationalizing impulses of contemporary neoliberal orthodoxy. In the same light, one might be tempted to think Trump's anti-China rhetoric and wall-building mania a turn against logistical globalization, a form of deglobalization, when in fact it is more likely to have at its heart an attempt by certain fractions of capital to re-globalize around new gateways and new corridors, with new international linkages to ward off the threat of China. This is evidenced by the overtures made to a Brexiting Britain and the murky connections of the administration to Russia, and in particular to extractive capitalism. The strategy here, and this is speculative, might be a kind of northern globalization based on domination of the new energy resources uncovered as the Arctic melts, opening up shortened trade routes between the US and Russia, and enough oil and gas to turn the Earth into Venus. New walls, but also new flows. The nation-state is not, in other words, a simple impediment to international flows, as the most vulgar conception of globalization would conclude. It is a sensitive instrument, capable of impeding certain flows, accelerating others, and redirecting still others. The nation-state mediates and enables the world market. Logistical globalization involves, paradoxically, the thickening rather than the attenuation of borders. As we saw with the Asia-Pacific Corridor and Gateway Initiative, logistical globalization allows nations to extend their sovereignty far beyond the borders. Or rather, the border is no longer identical with the geographical edges of a particular national territory. U.S. Customs and Border Protection officers are frequently stationed in foreign ports, inspecting U.S.-bound cargo before it ships. And at the very least, CBP will receive a digital manifest before goods ship, allowing it to flag certain containers and pre-clear others. In the case of air travel, this strange topology is particularly odd. The border exists not at the geographical edges of the US, but wherever international flights land. And passengers encountering customs agents in international airports have few of the rights they can expect from US police forces. All of your belongings are subject to search and seizure, and the authorities can detain you indefinitely, regardless of whether you are a U.S. citizen or not. Logistical globalization allows states the power to extend and thicken these exceptional legal spaces. For example, passengers traveling to the U.S. from Ireland, Canada, or the Arab Emirates pass through U.S. customs before boarding their plane. These are not spaces from which the state has departed, but highly militarized security zones that sort the flows of bodies and goods and treat them in a highly variable manner. Elite travelers who pay a special fee and submit to background checks can pass through international borders with only the slightest scrutiny, while others, almost always racialized in one way or another, will suffer lengthy detention and interrogation. The same is true for international flows of goods. Customs and border protection can only devote attention to certain containers, making the border a powerful tool to delay certain flows and expedite others. In conjunctural analyses of contingent political developments such as this, one must be careful to avoid what is sometimes called functionalism. That is, the idea that every development in the political sphere is somehow adequate to the needs of capital. The needs of capital in a direct extension of those needs. Not every policy or policy proposal need be rational from the standpoint of the capitalist class or some fraction thereof, either in the short or long term. Though over time, what is rational for at least some fraction will win out. for the simple reason that business leaders have enormous resources for making their own needs felt, first and foremost by the simple fact that governments are dependent upon a growing economy for their revenue base, and growth is, in turn, dependent on the presence of opportunities for profit-making and profit-taking. The threat of disinvestment steers the ship of state. The Trump administration's virulent anti-immigrant stance needs to be evaluated in light of these functions. Most business leaders recognize that immigration, in particular from Mexico and Central America, provides cheap labor essential to the reproduction of capitalism in the U.S. At the same time, immigrants provide an easy scapegoat for wage dependence in deindustrializing areas who might otherwise be tempted to blame elites or even capitalism in general for their problems. The most likely outcome of this contradiction between the needs of capitalist reproduction and a heretofore largely rhetorical economic nationalism is that we will get an intensification of what borders are already designed to do, not a blockage of the flows, but a more intense regulation and control of them. An attempt to legally recognize immigrant laborers and therefore submit them to the exceptional police powers of the now everywhere border, and in doing so, prepare them for hyper-exploitation, perhaps in a specially deregulated border exploitation zone. The administrative costs of such programs will be high, and the visibility afforded immigrants will allow for formal legal challenges. Most likely, then, unless it were to coincide with a total suspension of democratic norms, you know, such as they exist, such programs will exist alongside illegal immigration kept at allowable levels. The main point, however, is that Trump's wall pretends not so much to obstruct the flow of migrants, but to administer it, submit it to the newfound powers of the national state, transform it from free flow to walled flow, from scatter to channel. Not a barricade, then, but a container. If Trump's wall is more about control than simple obstruction, then from the perspective of the blockaders, the obstruction of one flow should really be seen as an attempt to liberate other flows from the control of capital in the state. In Standing Rock, No Dapple opposed the oil pipeline primarily because it threatened, if ruptured, to pollute the watershed upon which the tribes and others depended. The blockaders fought the pipeline where it would cross and potentially poison the ancient sustaining waters of the Missouri. The Lakota Sioux and other plains tribes once roamed freely on horseback for hundreds of miles in every direction from the No Dapple camps before they were killed in great numbers by settlers and U.S. troops and confined to an archipelago of reservations. The freeway blockades of Black Lives Matter, as we've already seen, counterpose one flow to another, an attempt to cut transversely against the carceral enclosures of the contemporary city where black life is set apart, policed, and imprisoned. These are just a couple of examples provided in order to demonstrate that the contemporary blockade is the dialectical negation of one flow and the affirmation of another. These struggles are, in other words, not simply attempts to delink and disconnect, to interrupt, though they are that too. They are also attempts to relink and reconnect and contain a recognition that these flows are both toxic and life-giving. For better or worse, we all depend upon them for our survival, and if we want to interrupt them finally, we will need to figure out how to reorganize society. This positive moment is, of course, undeveloped in the struggles at present. It is perhaps visible most clearly in the protest camps that are often, at the same time, blockades, and in the moments of looting that occur during riots. These are, of course, completely inadequate to the task of breaking free of the immiserating toxic flows of our post-industrial world, but they are a start. Thanks.